So our next speaker is a PhD student from the University of Buffalo, George, who will be talking about rapid prototyping. So George,
players. Thank you. Hope you can hear me. So good afternoon to me. I'm George Kilanikis from the University of Buffalo. I'm a PhD student. I work under Professor Babalama and Professor Vados. And part of this work today is in collaboration with Professor Tomas Mazovia from the Princeton University. And I will go over and mention some of the works that happened with new radio and USBs in extreme environments on how we used to say them in electrons in the UK. So this is the end of my talk. The main topic that I would like to study and give you an idea on what we're doing is underwater acoustics. So I know that you've seen yesterday talk on underwater. This was an optical. Here we are doing the acoustic, and what we try to do is actually have a highly configurable modem that can cope with the challenges basically that the underwater acoustic tunnel poses. So compared to the terrestrial tunnel, the underwater acoustic tunnel has high pop loss, has strong multipath and Doppler spread. It's highly dependent on the deployment environment. So an environment like a lake might be very different compared to an ocean or a river. The saltiness levels affect the communication, the depth, every noise that you might get from mammals or animals in different environments. So a specialized environment, you have large propagation delay variance compared to the terrestrial salmon, and you are also having sample coefficients that are temporarily spatial. So right now the state of the art is that the risk community in underwater is providing tailored protocols for different layers of the protocol stack. So people come up with optimized minimum access control protocols or physical layer protocols, and you just have to open, apply them, get some results, usually offline, and propose something different. So the challenge mainly is how can we efficiently utilize nowadays the spectrum resources with real-time adaptation underwater, apart from the terrestrial that we are currently doing in software defined radio. The current practices in underwater involve commercially available underwater acoustic modems, which are pretty expensive modems, mainly due to the housing and due to the capability of deploying into in many different environments. They come with proprietary protocol solutions, mostly inflexible, in order to add and rapidly test new functionalities. And recent research proposals, 2006, 2007, 2009, featured some survey type of works which suggested potential SDR benefits for the underwater community. But none of these works has actually went on to evaluate in real time the performance of the software-defined radio complete solution. So, one other question that may be posed is what are the needs of the next generation radios and what are the networks? So, we need what are the networks that consist of software-defined modems that can be easily deployed, and we can easily inject them into protocol designs and test them in on the fly. We need not interoperability in heterogeneous underwater networks. As you see on the picture here, you can have models that are symmetric on the ocean floor, and this will communicate with some models that are on the ocean surface, and then your base station will have a particle of a satellite, and so on and so forth. So you will have many heterogeneous technologies, and you need interoperability. And finally, you need real-time intelligent decision and adaptation to the to the rapidly changing environment. Coping behaviors and coping capabilities, again, have been well known and well studied in the REF domain. And recently, in 2014, again, in a survey paper, there has been a research on the potential challenges for implementing cognitive reporting algorithms. So, given all of that motivation and all the things that I mentioned, we thought that it would be a good idea to propose and deploy a complete software-defined system design for cognitive underwater acoustics. And what would be a better platform to do that would be the user thing. So what we did is we built a highly configurable user interface acoustic model prototype using commercial and research equipment. We designed mechanisms for flexible adaptation of fire and mud parameters. We designed a new robust feedback channel, which is based on chip modulation. Although it's a very well-known waveform, nobody has used it as a feedback at the end of the water. And in order to have successful adaptation, of course, you need a reliable feedback channel. And finally, we implemented and deployed the cognitive experts for multiple access and water communications. And evaluated, of course, the cognitive capabilities of the modem in real time. Real time, even though it's something that we get as granted in terrestrial and with the capabilities that the whole SAP family is offering, it's not by default in the Indian water community. Most people are doing, most research groups are actually organizing few streams out in the ocean, they collect some great amounts of data, and then new algorithms are applied offline, and they cannot guarantee to be real time. So our prototype is looking like that. It's based on a user key end to them, which is interfaced with the power amplifier and the pre-amplifier. Both of them are connected to an electronic switch, and the electronic switch is controlled by the GPIO inputs and outputs of the LFTX and LFIX protocols. So whenever you need to do PX, you will give a voltage over that general purpose pin, and you will trigger your control to allow your DX half of the time and the other half of the time. Both the pre-amplifier and the power amplifier that we've used are well known in the underwater community. They offer pretty good performance for high range testing and well fitting the range of frequencies that we wanted to experiment. So we are talking about acoustic, but the guided frequencies that we've used in the experiments that we follow are actually over the audible frequencies. So maybe we can follow it also ultrasound. Now going on to the finite mud layer adaptation, we came up with two kinds of technologies, if I can say them. Two kind of signaling setups. So we consider direct spectrum signaling setup, but we consider the case where in a multiple axis scenario, in a code division multiple axis scenario, where each user is assigned with has a predefined signature as sub I, the receiver of each of the pair of links that we have, we'll decide and send to the transmitter the code sequence SI, SIO, that maximizes the SNR in the presence of the multiple axis. Now, how this happens, I try to avoid most of the math that was dry, pretty dry for this kind of conference. So I'm showing you that this is an effective problem. So getting the bottom eigenvector to correspond to the bottom eigenvalue of this matrix over here, you get a good signature, a good binary vector S sub I, but if you feed that back to the transmitter of your link, you will be able to avoid your neighboring interference. So basically, you can have multiple coding region links, each one operating at its own optimal signature and achieving the maximum machine-learning performance. So we went and implemented this architecture in radio. The bottom figure describes the transmitter, and the bottom one the receiver. Most of the blocks here are well known and are available in the radio companion. There are some ones that have been customly developed, like the cost-saving block, which is nothing else actually than an FIR filter that is spreading your input over your signature. Our receiver is actually taking advantage of both the message passing and time typing features of that have been laid into the radio. So we have that looks that guarantee that both that our receiver is going to reconfigure the blocks that are dependent on the new signature. So every time that our receiver sends a new signature back to the transmitter, he has to adapt also some of his blocks to ensure that you will keep up with this new performance. The second setup is considering an orthogonal frequency division multiplexing. It's actually using K subcarriers, and instead of doing the classic cyclic prefix, we are doing a zero binding OFDM, mostly because we want some government delays among our blocks, among our OFDM blocks, because of the severe multi-pattern border. K-folds of them are uniformly positioned as pilot subcarriers for standard information purposes. And we offer options for adaptive modulation and coding. So we offer two options for modulation, BPSK and QPSK, and then the user can select among half-rate convolutional coding or completely encoding. The decision mechanism here is that the receiver decides and sends to the transmitter the modulation order and error correction coding rate that maximize the data rate subject to bit error rate reliability threshold. In other words, we have for each point-to-point link, we have a bit error rate reliability threshold, and we try to keep that threshold, and in the meantime, maximize our rate by adaptively changing our modulation program. How do we do that? We do that with these two flow graphs. These ones are not so much different from the benchmark OFDM running right now in the radio companion. The only differences are some message inputs and message outputs that allow for these programs to be adapted to the modulation and the codings. And finally, in order to adapt both the aforementioned signaling schemes, we need a reliable feedback channel. So we thought that chips have a very good behavior in multipath. We've tested them as preamble signals in underwater acoustics, and they proved to have very good correlation properties. And also, so this is their definition. F0 is the initial chip frequency, and then mu, which is defined as the difference of f of the final, the end chip frequency and the initial chip frequency, the chip frequency variation. Now, by varying that frequency difference, you can get quasi autonomous, so you can get basically an upsell and a downsell, and you can use an upsell to encode once, and you can use a downsell to encode zero. So what you gain from this scheme is that you will have a very low complexity receiver design, which will be actually two parallel correlators, one for an upsell and one for a downsell. And then the only thing that you will need to do is a big detector to decide if you have sent one or if you have sent zero. And seems, as I said, that resilient to strong multi-path and open store. These are again the flow graphs for the chip transmitter and the chip receiver. The chip receiver, as I said, is a bank of FIR filters. The first one having the taps of the up chip and the second one having the taps of the down chip. Getting the magnitude squared of this and identifying the peak, which peak is bigger, you can detect if you have sent a one or if you have sent a zero. Now the transmitter, we have already pre-installed the taps of an up chip and a down chip, and the only thing that we do is that when we need to transmit the feedback, we transmit a packet of ups and down chips. Finally, all these flow graphs, all these physical layer flow graphs that we've seen till now, are controlled with PDU messages from another layer MAC, which is nothing else than a Python-based code with message inputs and outputs that controls what kind of data vectors are going to be transmitted and also takes the decisions for adaptation for our transmitter and our receiver. Coming to the experimental setup, we have two kinds of setups. One is an intro setup in an underwater test tank. It's a pretty small tank, pretty narrow also tank, as you can see. And we have two users in this case and one receiver. So we're testing the adaptive spread spectrum signaling setup. So both user 1 and user 2 are preset in a random signature, SI. They both transmit at the same frequency, 95, centered at 95 kilohertz. They have a clock gain of 63. And we assume a number of 20 propagation paths. Because of the shape of the tank and the dimensions of it, the channel response looks like that. So it's pretty worse. The environment there is pretty worse comparing to a very shallow lake, as you are getting a lot of reflections both from the surface, from the bottom, and from the side. So what we plot here is the pre-detection SNR at our receiver and three for two types of scenarios. One type of scenario is what we call cognitive channelization, where users adapt their code. So every link is adapting its code in order to maximize its performance. And what you can see is actually the black dotted lines the black triangle marked lines are the performance when you are not adapting your signature. And the black circular lines are the performance that you get when you are adapting the signature. So you are getting a difference of around 10 dB when you are adapting your code in the presence of interference. The red line shows the same difference when you only have one user operating, so you are basically shutting this user off. And again, the same trend holds, but adapting to the noise of your environment actually is increasing your performance pretty significantly. And on the right you can see the bitter rate versus time figure, which is actually a function of this is an attribute. Another interesting thing is that we have tested two types of receivers, one completely blind receiver, which is using just a small amount of pilots for resolving phase ambiguities at the receiver due to the blind channel recognition. And compared that with the fully supervised receiver, where we're using a pretty long PN sequence for doing frame synchronization, channel estimation, etc. And the difference is actually the difference between the dust line and the solid dust line. The dust line is for the supervised and the solid line is for the blind. So you can see that the blind and the supervised have a very, very close performance indeed. The second setup was actually done in a lake. We are not so lucky due to the location and the weather that we have, so we have only the summer to do this, our experiment. But we are pretty lucky though to have a lake close to our apartment, and we brought all the equipment there, and we deployed the two nodes. The two transducers actually, we submerged them under the water in a distance of around 300 feet. However, this lake has a pretty low depth. It's less than 7 feet depth. So again, you're suffering from a lot of reflections from the bottom and a lot of mouth. And as you see, we've set a point-to-point link testing the zero value now, using 1024 subscribers. Still we have questions for QPSK and QPSK modulation, and one half convolutional error correcting codes or unrolling options. Now what we see here is three subplots for highest and for the time that you have highest NR around 20 degrees, and you get an acceptable bitter rate which is close to zero, as you can see with these rectangular markers, the scheme is actually using the highest rate modulation encoding, which is QPSK encoding. However, if we as we have set our threshold around 10 to the minus 2, as you can see when the SNR is getting lower than 10 degrees, what our system does is that it's sacrificing its rate in order to bring down the bitter rate to an acceptable threshold. So the rectangular markers as they follow is actually the fixed case where you do not adapt, but you are keeping your data rate high, and this case here with the triangular and markers is actually adapting between QPSK encoded, then it's changing to QPSK half-coded until it reaches back again to QPSK encoded. So it's actually a really good realization and visualization of how a real-time adaptive system can trade off bitter rate performance for data in runtime. Here again are some, the bitter rate results actually versus SNR, and this is where we set our threshold, and this is a realization, a snapshot of our feedback budget. This is like what the feedback packet of 3 bits looks like. These two scopes are two correlation scopes, one on the down chip and one on the up chip. So basically you can simply recall here that we have sent a down chip, an up chip, and a down chip. Basically this can be a 0, 1, 0. And this can denote that you you have to adapt your coding and go from hard coding to hard coding, or go from BPSK to BPSK. You can give whatever kind of protocol you want to your feature file. Another thing is that we also showed that we can seamlessly switch between the two schools. So we did have some zero particular VM budgets, we did have some spread spectrum budgets, and we made a Mac that can change between them in order to get advantage of both of them. Let me conclude quickly. So we implemented a real-time adaptive model based on the software-defined principles. We proposed and implemented a new feedback, a new robust feedback and water channel. Now, work in progress that I want to point out is that we are currently working on the modern video streaming using the same kind of prototype, and we're actually getting some very exciting results. And what we'd like to propose is that it would be a nice idea to start porting some channeling data into radio, which are currently for underwater communications, and why not maybe create a VR plus underwater out of remote, where developers can contribute. Developers can contribute underwater communications. Now, I think the last two slides are describing two test beds that are currently running by two other professors in our department. So, Professor Mastanavi is running a project with the Air Force Research Lab for software-defined autonomous airport networks. So they are making a custom quadcopter with an infrared on top of that. And they have implemented all the logic in new radio and QT framework. And another interesting test we've done in our group is that on underground communications. So basically using the GSMP with custom coil antennas for communicating underground. Apart from an underwater tank, we also have a soil tank, so we can do the experiments there as well. Testbeds that have been implemented now is indoor localization testbed based on magnetic induction, a 3x3 MIMO testbed, and so on. Thank you.